Well, good afternoon. I'm Daniel Benjamin. I'm the director of the Dickey Center, and I'm delighted to welcome you to this event on Europe's refugee crisis. I certainly want to thank all of you who resisted the temptation to be outside on one of the fall's most beautiful days. And it's something we struggle with every fall here at Dartmouth, except when we're struggling with it in late spring. Well, I can hardly think of a more timely subject for discussion than the issue of the current refugee crisis in Europe. That image on the cover of this week's Time magazine, I might add, if you can read in the lower right-hand corner, is by Dartmouth's Jim Nachtway, who, for all I know, is hiding in the room. But that picture, I believe, was taken on the island of Lesbos, where many of the Syrian refugees are coming ashore, and we're going to hear a lot more about the situation on the ground there. But as I said, this could hardly be a better timed discussion, even if the weather hasn't cooperated by driving people indoors. And it's hard to think of one that touches us. One that would touch us all even more directly than this one does, because whether it's our moral sensibilities that are shaped by our cultural and religious heritage and the many repetitions that one finds in the Bible of the injunction to treat well the strangers who are in our midst, or our own American founding myth and our national understanding as a place of refuge, and that sentiment which every schoolchild knows is memorialized on the Statue of Liberty. Well, because of all of that, the current crisis, I think, hits us very hard. The crisis, it's worth pointing out, has been going on now for many years, and I think our speakers will discuss that fact. And every year we've seen increasing numbers of refugees. There has been a significant uptick this year, and that is part of the reason that I think we're all so concerned about the refugee crisis now. Another reason, of course, is that it crystallized in just the last 6 or so weeks when, despite the staggering statistics, there was a picture of a 3-year-old young boy, Aylan Kurdi, who had died drowning, I believe also coming ashore at Lesbos, when the raft that was carrying him and his family capsized. And that picture has been on every newspaper in every country in the world at this point. What's seldom recognized or mentioned is that the same accident killed his mother, his 5-year-old brother, and 12 passengers in all, leaving only his father from that family. I think another reason why it's crystallized is that there's a sense of distress that we feel. And I think that owes to two facts. First, there's that sense that we are farther from the end than ever before, and that as we look at the Syrian civil war and the intervention by the Russians, any resolution seems more distant and more unlikely. Similar things could be said about Afghanistan and Iraq, which are also at the top of the charts for providing refugees, even if those places aren't quite as dire as Syria. But troubled and failing states are supplying enormous numbers of people, or watching their people essentially set adrift on the seas or across continents. And there seems to be limitless fallout from the Arab Spring and from states such as Eritrea or Nigeria, which are fragile, badly damaged, and inhospitable to their own people. A second reason why this perhaps feels so acute right now is that the institutions that are on the front lines of the crisis themselves seem strained and imperiled by it, possibly unable to cope and in danger of being swamped like one of those rafts crossing from Turkey to Greece or Libya to Italy. And that's why I think it's so vital to come together now and to act as a community, inform ourselves, and consider what more we can do. And I think that's why when the idea of this event was first aired, there was strong support from the Provost's office, from the Dean of the College, from the Leslie Center, and from the Dickey Center. And I'm delighted that all those different parts of the campus have come together to convene this event. We have a very distinguished panel, and I want to start by thanking them for coming here. The very first speaker is Bob Kitchen of the International Rescue Committee. Mr. Kitchen is the director of the IRC's Emergency Preparedness and Response Unit, and as such is responsible for all the emergency and crisis intervention programs worldwide. And we know that IRC has an enormous number of programs in that category. He also manages his organization's emergency response team, which is often the first international humanitarian assistance group to arrive at the scene of a crisis. He's been working in this field since 1999, where he began, I guess, in southern Albania. He's worked in Kosovo, East Timor, Sierra Leone, and since joining IRC, he has been in Iraq and Darfur, Chad, the Central African Republic, Indonesia, Nepal, and the Democratic Republic of Congo. He is just back from the island of Lesbos, and he will begin with a discussion of what's been going on that island. I do want to just take one slight detour from introducing the panelists by just saying a word about IRC. When I first thought about who to have here, I was desperately hoping that I would get Bob Kitchen or another Bob Kitchen type, although I'm not sure there are any other Bob Kitchen types. But because IRC does such an extraordinarily good job, and since it was founded 80 years ago by Albert Einstein to take care of refugees from Hitler's Europe, it has become one of the greatest institutions in the world today in terms of caring for those who have no one else to care for them. And they just do an extraordinary job. I mean, some of the statistics are quite remarkable. Just last year, IRC helped 17.6 million people whose lives were shattered by conflict, provided 16 million people with primary and reproductive health care, gave 3.3 million people access to clean drinking water. When we think about what differences we make on this earth, those are the kinds of numbers that I think ought to make everyone's eyes light up. And while I don't want to do too hard a pitch here, I think if anyone's thinking about what more they can do for refugees when they leave, the IRC is an acronym they should keep in mind. Dartmouth and IRC, by the way, have a very close relationship, and I'm delighted that two current overseers from the IRC's board are with us, Ken French, professor at Tuck, and Jim Strickler, former dean of the medical school, who also used to be co-chair of the International Rescue Committee. And now about our other panelists, Sir Michael Leigh is a Transatlantic Academy Fellow, consultant, and senior advisor at the German Marshall Fund. He came to the German Marshall Fund after a very distinguished career at the European Union. He spent some 30 years there, culminating with becoming the director general or the top civil servant dealing with enlargement. And he, I guess most of those years, he was dealing with the external relations of the EU and therefore is intimately familiar with the politics and the situations, really. I mean, all the facts of everyone in the EU neighborhood stretching far into the Middle East. He began, believe it or not, as an academic. You were an assistant professor of international relations at Johns Hopkins University and a lecturer at the University of Sussex. And he holds degrees from Oxford and from MIT, where he received his PhD. He was knighted on January 1st, 2012 for his services to the enlargement of the European Union. And I can tell you that that's a much better reward for services rendered than anything that happens in the US government. And finally, Graziella Parati will be our third panelist. She is the Paul Paganucci Professor of Italian Literature and Language, teaches comparative literature and women's and gender studies. She is also the newly installed director of the Leslie Center for the Humanities, and she has written extensively on migration, including such titles as Migration Italy, The Art of Talking Back in a Destination Culture, The Cultures of Italian Migration, Mediterranean Crossroads, and Multicultural Literature in Contemporary Italy. So we have a great group of experts and scholars here, and I think I'll start off with you, Bob.
Thank you, everyone, for coming in this afternoon. I'm really looking forward to talking to you all about the European refugee crisis and hearing from my expert colleagues as they deliver their remarks and engage with you in questions as we get to the Q&A section. As you've heard, I work for the International Rescue Committee. Dan has done his homework better than I could, so I'll just give you the briefest of rundowns. As Dan said, we were created at the suggestion of Albert Einstein in 1933, when our first act was to help evacuate academics, artists, and intellects out of Nazi-occupied Europe and help them start new lives here in the US. Our history has moved on from that point, engaging in all of the world's major conflicts and natural disasters over the 83 years, where we've helped communities and people survive through conflict, recover as the situation stabilizes, and then regain control of their lives. We've done that by deploying programs that help people remain safe, people remain healthy and educated and economically well and powerful within their own communities. So that's the IRC. As Dan said, I've worked with the organization for 14 years now, and I genuinely have the best job in the world because I get to, on a day-to-day basis, manage a team of 35 expert aid workers who deploy into the field within 24 hours of a new crisis, and they work tirelessly to set up new programs to save lives. So it's an incredibly rewarding job. I have returned yesterday from the island of Lesbos in Greece. So you'll be hearing from me today firsthand reports and enjoying my jet lag together this afternoon. What I'd like to do is just talk through the journey that people are facing as they depart their countries in the Middle East through Greece and then onwards up into Europe. So I'll be focusing mostly on Greece, but I did want to portray the whole trip through Greece and then up into Europe. It's a crisis that has filled our newspapers and television screens over the last few weeks and months. But the one thing that I want everybody to go away with hearing is that it's not a new crisis. This is a result of protracted warfare and conflict in places like Syria and Afghanistan and Iraq that the Western world has failed to bring to a halt over the last decade. So this is 10 years of suffering and people being uprooted in the face of large-scale conflict. So it's not a new conflict. Of the 450,000 people that have arrived into Greece just this year alone, 18% have come from Afghanistan. They've come from a country that is currently seeing an increasingly strong Taliban, and the government of President Ashraf Ghani slowly realizing that they don't exert much influence outside of the urban centers. In the last few weeks, we've seen one concrete example of the Taliban's capacity on the rise, where they took briefly the northern city of Kunduz. I served in Afghanistan for 2 years, and it would have been unthinkable back then that the Taliban would take and hold a city even for a few days. And this is what we're hearing from people as they arrive onto the shores of Greece, that their country is now ruled, their communities are living under the control of the Taliban. They're being forced to increasingly make the decision as to which side they fight for. Their families are no longer able to move sufficiently to be able to secure work and earn sufficient income to look after their families. So they're having to make the tough decision to move. President Ghani's government has realized this and has instituted new programs. And instead of to stop this exodus, instead of programs that are staffed by soldiers and guns, this time it's through social media and social services. Because I think the government is very clear that, as with many refugee crises, the first to leave are those with education and with resources. And if this movement continues from Afghanistan, it's going to be another major brain drain on the country. So that's Afghanistan. The largest refugee contributing nation within this crisis is, of course, Syria, with more than 70% of the people coming into Greece coming from Syria itself. With now more than half of the nation's 21 million population forcibly displaced from their homes and in urgent need of humanitarian relief. Within its the fifth year of war, this really is the largest war the world has at the moment, the most severe humanitarian crisis, and ground zero for this European refugee crisis. This is where the bulk of the refugees are coming from. And what we're hearing on the ground, it really speaks to numbers that I think everybody here, myself included, really struggle to get a handle on because they're so big. 12.4 million people needing humanitarian relief to save their lives. 4.1 million people who are now refugees outside of Syria, having been forced to flee their homes due to on-the-ground violence every single day, bombing from an increasingly diverse international community trying to intervene. And again, the reality that they can no longer move to take jobs to secure the income that their families need to survive. They're fleeing Syria into small countries with small populations and very sensitive politics that these countries are having to manage. So 700,000 in Jordan, well over a million now in Lebanon, and approaching 2 million in Turkey. These countries are doing well to fulfill their obligations under international refugee law by keeping their doors open, but it's at a severe cost. These countries are seeing their economies and social service sectors falter because of these massive influx of people. And what's making matters even worse is that the international resources flowing in to try and help this large population of 4 million refugees, the resources are now very scarce. Again, big numbers to get our heads around, but the current annual appeal for the regional refugee crisis for 2015 is worth $4.5 billion. So huge money. And we're now three quarters of the way through the year, and so far the UN and international community has raised just less than half of that number. So that flows down, that percentage of numbers flows down into services where half of the humanitarian aid that has been delivered over the years is now stopped, including life-saving, just general food distributions. Half as much food is being distributed in Lebanon today than it was last year. So again, the refugees who have sought asylum and protection within these refugee hosting countries are now feeling in the face of insecurity and dwindling humanitarian aid, they're having to move. 4.1 million refugees, the larger population of concern is actually the 7.6 million people who've been driven from their homes but have hung on in IDP camps and host communities within Syria as internally displaced people. They are the largest portion of the refugees now coming through Europe because, much the same, they face day-to-day bombing, the huge harassment, forced conscription at the hands of the various militia groups operating in Syria, and absolutely no economic opportunities. So even in the face of hanging on for 4 years to safeguard their homes and their land, they too are now feeling as though they need to leave, and they're heading north towards Turkey's coasts. Numbers for the international resources going into Syria, they're smaller because access is constrained by the violent conflict going on, but still very large numbers and very disappointing percentages. So during this calendar year 2015, the annual appeal is worth $2.8 billion and currently stands at just over 33% funded. So again, nowhere near the sort of aid that people need to survive. They're heading towards Turkey, which is a very different country than it was 5 years ago. 5 years ago, it was a stable, cosmopolitan world power on the rise. Its economy was growing as fast as any other country in the world. It was peaceful after a hard-fought but seemingly durable peace deal with the rebel separatist group, the Kurdish PKK. They were even leading in international commerce and even aid, where they took the lead in funding and personnel into places like South Sudan and Somalia. It really was a country on the rise. They opened their doors, their borders, to receive hundreds of thousands of refugees coming across from Syria. They built, developed world-leading refugee camps for the Syrians as they arrived. But 4.5 years on, this has taken a massive toll, as has the war in Syria, which has been very divisive for it as a country. Over the last 4 years, it's spent as a country $6.5 billion looking after the refugees. And over that time, the pressures of the war and domestic policies has really seen the country completely change. It now has a stretched and stagnant economy. It has reverted to fighting with the PKK, some say because of domestic politics and President Erdogan trying to use the war to get back into power. And it's run out of resources to help the refugees. During this decline in stability, large and very violent criminal gangs have taken advantage and have launched large-scale smuggling operations from the western towns of Izmir and Bodrum, where they're making tens of millions of dollars from the world's most vulnerable people as they move them across a six-mile channel of sea across to Greece. Refugees are arriving from Syria. They arrive into Izmir and are approached in downtown coffee shops. Izmir and Bodrum have changed from being hosts to people seeking sun and cappuccinos to selling life jackets to refugees. The refugees are approached in downtown coffee shops by the smugglers, who promise safe, large, stable boats to cross the channel at the small price of $1,200 per person. It's 6 miles across and it's $1,200. And another statistic that I heard and was disgusted by was that the price of an infant's life jacket was four times as much as an adult's life jacket. It's just exploitation, the very definition of exploitation. As they hand over the money, they're given a six-digit code that is used in lieu of a ticket, and they're asked for their cell phone number. And then late at night, they receive a phone call from the smugglers, who tell them to go to a certain point in the town where they're picked up by buses and driven 2 miles to the coastal departure point, where they arrive and shockingly don't see large, safe, stable boats. They see rubber dinghies with underpowered motors and often no pilot. So it's the refugees that have to charter their way across this channel all on their own. I've met refugees in Lesbos over the last few weeks that got midway across the channel and the boat stopped, the engine conked out. They were lucky because they did have a trained pilot, but when the motor stopped, the pilot jumped overboard and swam back to Turkey and left them in the middle. Now Syrians and Iraqis who were in the boat, they're landlocked countries, they don't know how to swim. As panic started, the boat was overflowing with water and eventually it capsized. And the individual I was talking to, the man I was talking to, a guy called Mohammed, I could see he was standing in the refugee camp. He had scars all over his arms and legs. And I was talking to him about his experience. And he said it was terrifying. And he was able to swim. He was one of the few people who could swim, but he was with five other friends who couldn't swim. So what he had to do was he had to drag his friends one by one towards the coast of Greece. He had a cell phone in a shrink wrap bag, and he was able to use Google Maps to show him the right way to swim. And he went back and forth. Eventually that didn't work, his phone died, but he went back and forth and he dragged his five friends. It took him 7 hours to drag them towards the coast. And the scars that he had on his arms was because he was wearing denim, and he was swimming for 7 hours with denim, and they just, the burns all thin his arms. It's stories like these in 21st century Europe. It shouldn't be like this. So the IRC has been able to swing into action. We've been in Greece since the end of June. We're one of a very, very small group of operational organizations on the ground. As people arrive onto these beaches, it's really one of the both happy and sad things I've ever seen. As Daniel said, I've worked in all of the world's humanitarian crises, some of the worst war zones over the last 15 years, and I've never seen such scenes of both strength and suffering in the same place at the same time, where my colleagues and I, on a day-to-day basis, watch these beaches full of bikini-wearing European socialites, and then this boat full of 50 Syrians wash up and they clamber out, and the socialites kind of pull the sunglasses down and look over the Kindles as people clamber out of these boats. It is completely bizarre. And it's the jubilation that the refugees show, that there's yells of happiness and high fives, and people are taking selfies. And that's really what the sad thing is, because they think they're now in Europe and they're safe. And I know they still have a massively long, very expensive and pretty dangerous journey ahead of them to get onwards up through to mainland Europe. The IRC is helping in two ways. First, refugees, before they're registered, can't procure any services in Greece. It was a very short-sighted policy by the Greeks who thought that it would deter people from coming across. So they can't buy taxis or bus tickets. So up until the IRC became operational, they were having to walk 40 miles from the top of the island down to Mytilene, where they can register and buy tickets to ferries to cross to Greece. Over the last month, IRC, working in partnership with Doctors Without Borders and the UN, have provided 1,500 buses, and we've transported 100,000 people that 40 kilometres, so they don't have to walk in the heat of the summer in Greece. When they get down to Mytilene, we provide them information about where they are, what the situation is, how to get registered, where humanitarian services are available, how to get tickets to the ferries, and what it's like when they get to mainland Europe. One of the big changes in the 21st century aid work is that all of the refugees have much better cell phones than I do, and they're connected to the internet. So the first thing they do when they get off the boat and they've stopped taking selfies is go and buy themselves a new SIM card so they can get on the internet. So we've now launched a new website with all of this information on the website, so people can log in and find out where they are, where they're going, where the map is, and etc. So it's a brave new world for us aid workers. We've also, a second big push from our side is to make sure that we realise that this 150,000 who arrived, 150,000 refugees who arrived on Lesbos alone during September are not breaking the island of Lesbos, which is a small tourist place. So we've installed a large transit camp outside Mytilene, the maiden town, providing tents and toilets and clean water and showers so people can live with some dignity as they wait to be registered. And we've also worked with the municipal authorities to make sure that they have the capacity. We've enlarged their capacity to collect refuse and provide public toilets. As at the height of the refugee crisis in August, the refugees outnumbered the population of Mytilene by about 1.2. So it was about 25,000 people living in Mytilene. It was about 35,000 refugees. Very bizarre place to be. Once they're registered, and this is an evolving situation as Europe starts to fulfill in the primary phase the agreements the European leaders made in Brussels a few weeks ago. Instead of registering with Greek authorities, the refugees now have to register with an inter-European force called Frontex, which is made up of border police and normal police from European countries. It's a new part of a process that Europe is putting in place to create refugee processing centres, which unhelpfully are going to be called hotspots, which is a strange title, where all of the refugees, all of the migrants arriving have their asylum claims processed in a much smaller number of places. The first 120,000 who have their status determined as refugees are then sent to European states based on the quota system that the European governments have agreed to. We're unsure what will happen to refugee number 120,001. No one has decided that yet, but we're quite worried about that. For all of the people who are not deemed refugees, they're going to be deported and sent back to their country of origin. We don't know how that's going to work at the moment either, because people are just having basic registration at the moment. They then buy the tickets for the ferry and sail across to Athens. And this is where the journey continues, and it's built on the bus network of Europe, as Eastern European states have followed each other in creating a system which is really based on the principle of passing the buck. So Macedonia, Serbia, Croatia, and Hungary have all now adopted the same protocols, where they close all but one of their international border crossings. So Hungary has 8, Croatia has 9, Serbia has a number. They close all but one, so they're channeling the refugees through one point. And at that point, they have essentially all of the buses in the country waiting for the refugees. The refugees register, they're given 72 hours to move to the capital and claim asylum, which is impossible, or get out of the country. They get on buses, they drive across the country to the next single open border crossing, cross, register, buses, and so it continues up through Europe. And it'll continue that way as these very xenophobic states who don't want refugees putting down roots in their countries continue to channel them through. And it'll continue until Germany either closes its border because they just don't have the capacity to receive any more people, or the politics in Germany closes the border irrespective of capacity. And I think we're on the way to that. And then we fear what will happen is a domino effect where all of the other states close the borders. So we're setting up a number of things. One, we're providing support to Serbian groups, local organizations that the IRC has long relationships with, having set them up or supported them during the Balkans War. They're very happy to see us back. They're very happy to work with us. And we're providing funding so they can do very similar programs that we're doing in Greece, providing people with information. And then when and wherever they need it, the basic warm clothes and blankets and high energy food to be able to continue on their journey. The second thing we're doing is acknowledging that if these borders do close, there will be people stuck along the way. So we're creating a European surge team that will be based in Athens to be able to deploy northwest into Macedonia, Serbia, or Croatia, or northeast to the Turkish-Bulgarian border. Because as the seas get rougher, as the winter arrives, more and more people will try and cross by land through Bulgaria, which is a pretty rough country. The numbers arriving into Serbia at the moment of refugees are telling stories about paying large amounts of money to smugglers to guide them through the mountain forests of Bulgaria towards Serbia, being abandoned by those smugglers halfway through and then being set upon by different gangs who beat them up and take everything that they've got before they cross into Serbia. So again, we're going to be there to be able to support them, given the extreme violence that they're fleeing from. It's a large and complex and rapidly evolving crisis, and one that I'm incredibly proud of the work the IRC is doing within alongside other NGOs, and I'm really looking forward to answering your questions later on. So thank you very much.
Well, good afternoon, everybody, and thank you very much to Dan for inviting me to join you this afternoon. After that extremely moving presentation of the situation facing so many of these refugees, I'm going to take a step back before coming again to the refugee problem to try and locate these developments in the series of crises that Europe is facing today, and looking at how these crises interact with each other and what some of the consequences could be for the EU. But before I come to that, and no levity intended, when Dan invited me a few moments ago to take the floor, he first introduced me to Bob and said he has the same accent as you. My repartee wasn't quick enough, but I should have said, but the thing is, we have no accent. As Dan said, after a brief academic career, I've spent much of my career in the EU, working in different parts of the institutions in Brussels, mainly related to external relations, but I also played a role in bringing some of the countries that have been mentioned into the EU, and for the Balkan countries and for Turkey, in preparing them for future EU membership. So I feel very much involved personally, given the key role that many of these countries are now playing or should play. But before coming to such questions, let me just say that at the moment, the European Union is facing four major crises. First of all, as we've heard from Bob, Europe's incapacity as it stands to cope with the current unprecedented wave of refugees, predominantly from the Middle East, especially Syria and from Africa, but also from the Balkans and from Afghanistan. The crisis, as we've heard from Bob, is of unprecedented proportions and one that perhaps in the end will pose a challenge to the EU of the same scale, for example, as that which followed the fall of communism. The second major crisis facing the EU still concerns the EU's currency union, the Eurozone, in which 19 of its 28 members participate. We haven't heard quite so much about that in the media recently after the $86 billion bailout package was agreed for Greece, but this is only a temporary calm. The problem will return. The underlying structural issues have not been addressed. The governance of the Eurozone has not been addressed, and there are still serious structural weaknesses in Greece, Portugal, Italy, France, and perhaps some other member states. Cyprus and Ireland are now doing well in emerging from their bailout packages, but nonetheless, I think the crisis and the set of issues related to the euro will come back. The third unresolved crisis concerns Russia's annexation of the Crimea and military support for separatists in the east of the country. There too, there has been something of a ceasefire of late, but none of the underlying issues have been resolved, and this is a problem that Europe will continue to grapple with. And finally, but perhaps in human terms, not on the same proportions as obviously the problem that we're mainly focusing today, the refugee issue, but nonetheless, the risk that the United Kingdom may leave the European Union, a possibility known in Europe as Brexit, British exit, which has acquired its own acronym, and which will be the focus of British politics and of Britain's interactions with the EU for the next couple of years at least, if not for a much longer period. These four crisis areas are interacting and reinforcing each other. For example, the migration crisis and the euro crisis taken together are reinforcing eurosceptical claims in the UK, France, and elsewhere that the EU just isn't working, and bring further grist to the mill of populist political parties. Migration in its different forms is a focus for discontent within several EU member states and a focus for the populist political parties we see in many countries in Europe today. The refugee crisis is also driving wedges between different EU countries. The UK, for example,'s highly restrictive approach on refugees, who are still widely seen in Britain as welfare tourists, is driving a deeper wedge between London and Berlin. And yet London and Berlin must work together closely if a package is to be put together that can be presented to the British people probably next year before a referendum as the basis for a decision on whether the UK remains in the EU. The rift between Germany and some central European countries on migration make it more difficult to adopt a common position vis-à-vis Ukraine and Russia, and may be one of the factors that could help bring nationalists back to power in Warsaw in the forthcoming elections. A lack of solidarity, as it is often perceived in Germany, with Germany, by certain other member states who are not willing to do their part in resettling refugees, even France is not enthusiastic, may make it harder to mobilize support in Germany for shoring up the euro and for future bailouts. Chancellor Merkel and the French President Hollande put on a show of cooperation at the European Parliament last week to try and revive the Franco-German locomotive that has done so much to push European integration forward in the past. But Franco-German divergences on refugees are huge. France is planning to rehouse just 16,000 refugees this year and next, whereas Germany is facing 800,000 requests for asylum, which some in Germany have calculated may rise to as many as 1 million or even 1.5 million over the next years. There are also other ways in which the refugee crisis is affecting Europe's search for a solution to the euro problem. For example, the influx of refugees into Germany, and as Bob said, the first wave often consists of quite highly qualified refugees, has been welcomed in Germany in part, it's often been said, because of the demographic issues that Germany is facing, not with 80 million people, having too small a population, but the proportion of the working age population declining compared with those who are not working. And in the first instance, at least, it's expected that an influx of refugees, despite a minimum wage in Germany, is going to put downward pressure on labor costs in Germany, making Germany even more competitive and therefore threatening the economic imbalances in Europe as perhaps being even greater, one of the obstacles to a solution to the euro problem. Some draw comfort from the argument that the EU has always needed a crisis to take a new step towards greater integration. However, I think in the current condition of the refugee crisis, it would be very hard to conclude that this crisis is likely to provoke a major breakthrough in the near future. Coming now to the refugee crisis itself, with the euro crisis, this is by far the most serious existential challenge facing the EU today. I won't go over the statistics at this point, but the numbers are indeed quite overwhelming. Almost 500,000 people have made the perilous journey across the Mediterranean from the Middle East and North Africa to Europe, mainly to Greece and Italy this year. Many have died at sea. As we've heard, refugees from Afghanistan, Syria, Iraq, and elsewhere in the Middle East have headed mainly for Turkey. Many have headed mainly for Greece, many through Turkey. Refugees from East Africa and Sub-Saharan Africa have headed mainly for Italy. Libya, now essentially a failed state, is the main departure point for refugees aiming for Italy. Trafficking of refugees and others is said to have become the second highest revenue earner in Libya, a figure has been given of some 250 million per month, the second highest revenue earner after oil, which has been badly hit by the crisis. Up to 20 boats of different descriptions have been leaving Libya every day during the so-called summer sailing season. And in southern Italy, criminal gangs, in some cases linked to the mafia, are involved. There have been several important arrests by Italian police. They're doing the best job possible in Sicily, also from Rome, and they're gearing up for a major campaign against traffickers. Maybe we'll have number four, this one. The ultimate goal of many refugees is to seek asylum in Germany and Switzerland. These are the predominant routes that are being followed by the refugees at the moment. As we've heard, many more refugees are in Turkey, Jordan, and Lebanon, imposing a massive burden on these countries, which have their own fragilities. In Jordan, for example, Bob gave the figure of 700,000 from Syria, but in total there may be a million or more, and these are imposing a huge burden on public finances and energy supplies in Jordan. Jordan is doing its best to educate some of the young refugees at the cost of some $1,000 a head of each refugee attending high school in Jordan, funds that Jordan simply doesn't have. A few words on Turkey, a country that I've worked with a great deal in the past. Turkey is hosting around 2 million refugees, most of them outside of camps. It says it spent something like 7 billion euros so far on accommodating them. Mr. Erdogan, the president, was in Brussels last week and there were detailed discussions. The EU has so far offered 1 billion euros in support, as well as a 500 million trust fund, far too little in Turkey's view, particularly as some of these funds have been allocated previously to Turkey already for other purposes. It's clear that Turkey needs support to better filter economic migrants from asylum seekers. Some of Turkey's own policies need to be looked at again. It has a very light e-visa rule for visitors from other Muslim countries, and Syrians and Iraqis are granted guest status, not refugee status in general in Turkey, which means that the international rules applying to refugees don't automatically apply to them. Clearly, the EU needs to provide considerable more financial support for repatriation of those who are refused asylum and who are considered to be economic migrants. They have their own case, but they don't fall under requests for asylum, so that Turkey and the EU, for that matter, can devote more attention to those who have legitimate claims for asylum. At present, the EU has a readmission agreement with Turkey, which obliges Turkey to take back Turkish nationals for the moment who are illegal immigrants to the EU. Turkey is a major source of migration into the EU, and for the time being, Turkey has no obligation to take back third country citizens. So this is an issue that needs to be clarified in the near future. There needs to be more cooperation with Turkey, but unfortunately, there's a high level of mutual distrust. One of the things the EU could do to dispel that distrust would be to satisfy a long-standing Turkish demand for visa-free travel for its citizens to the EU. But unfortunately, there's little mood for this in the EU at the moment. One of the problems that Bob alluded to is the changing pattern of politics in Turkey and the continued human rights abuses, whether of the freedom of the press, freedom of expression, various other fundamental rights and freedoms, which are criticized in the EU's reports and in its interactions with Turkey as a candidate country, have somewhat reduced willingness on the part of some member states to cooperate closely with Turkey. Nonetheless, during President Erdogan's visit to Brussels last week, the two sides did agree to work together on several of the key questions concerning the refugees. New refugee flows to the EU from Africa and the Middle East come on top of the asylum requests that Bob mentioned from people leaving Balkan countries like Serbia, Macedonia, Albania, Bosnia, and Kosovo. These countries all have close links with the EU and are in principle on a path towards EU membership. This year, asylum requests from the Balkans made up more than a quarter of all the requests in the EU and nearly half of the requests in Germany. Political refugees from the Balkans are often Roma fleeing discrimination, but many who leave the Balkans to head for Austria, Germany, and Northern Europe are economic migrants seeking to escape poverty and unemployment and claiming refugee status. One of the issues that Europe has to face is that until now, each European country has had its own rules for defining safe countries from which requests for asylum are not accepted. It would be a step forward for the EU as such to establish a list of safe countries, and the Commission has proposed that all those headed for a path towards membership in the Balkans be considered with some exceptions, for example, concerning the Roma safe countries from which applications for asylum will not be accepted. The question of Turkey is particularly difficult. The Commission has proposed that Turkey be included also as a safe country, but this is something that several member states reject. So clearly we have a number of issues to solve, and we have to provide more support to Turkey, Lebanon, and Jordan, but there are many obstacles still that have to be cleared away before we can do that. Internal border controls have been imposed for the first time within the Schengen group of countries. One of the EU's main achievements is the abolition of internal border controls between the countries that you see in blue on this map. And for the first time, controls have been re-established at internal borders, as well as the notorious razor wire fence that has been built that you see in red there between Hungary and Serbia. So one of the main challenges facing Europe, and one of the reasons why this, along with the euro crisis, is perceived as a threat to some of Europe's fundamental achievements, is because internal border controls have been imposed, calling into question the principle of the free movement of people under the so-called Schengen Convention, one of the EU's fundamental achievements. Populist movements from Hungary to Finland have responded sometimes violently to the influx of refugees. The razor wire fence that I mentioned between Hungary and Serbia, as well as well-publicized scenes in Hungarian railway stations, were planned deliberately by Mr. Orban to discourage refugees from heading for Hungary, but also to draw voters away from extreme nationalist parties like Jobbik. It turns out, in reality, that because of its geographical location, a rather high number of requests for asylum have been received by Hungary. Here you see asylum claims in Europe in 2015, and Hungary actually figures as the second country where such requests have been made after Germany. And the situation has been taken up by Mr. Orban for political purposes in the hope that he can trounce those who criticize his position from the right. Mandatory quotas to settle 160,000 of the refugees present in Italy and Greece were approved by the EU Council of Ministers last week, despite contrary votes from the Czech Republic, Hungary, Romania, and Slovakia. Other countries who voted in favor clearly have severe reservations, such as France and a number of other Schengen countries, and the UK made clear that it would take its own decisions on accommodating refugees and would not be subject to these obligatory quotas within the Schengen group of countries. It's actually unprecedented for the EU to take a major decision in this way, ignoring objections from countries that claim that they have vital national interests at stake. Without going into the rights and the wrongs of the situation, this changes the way the EU does business. And the four countries who voted against are likely to resist in practice the imposition of these quotas. And there are very few means that Hungary, for example, can be obliged to fulfill the quota that has been assigned to it. All of this creates a rather poisonous atmosphere at a time when there are other vital issues of the sort that I mentioned to you, which need to be tackled. The position taken by the Hungarian government in particular is seen in Germany and elsewhere as abandonment of one of the fundamental principles on which the EU is based. But Mr. Orban is riding high in the opinion polls in his own country and seems to be achieving his own short-term local political goals. There has been some speculation in Germany that the EU might even resort to a principle that exists under Article 50 of the EU Treaty, whereby a country's voting rights in the Council of Ministers can be suspended if there are serious and persistent violations of EU laws. However, it seems most unlikely that in practice this cumbersome procedure is likely to be followed. And member states in general are reluctant to take such measures against others because they are afraid that they could well be in the hot seat next time. Mr. Orban and others claim that Germany's more welcoming stance towards refugees is part of the problem and not part of the solution. They claim that it has functioned as a magnet attracting refugees who then have to transit their countries. Chancellor Merkel is resisting pressure not only from the anti-immigrant party Pegida, but also from senior figures in her own party, the CDU, and especially in its sister party in Bavaria, the CSU. Even the Social Democratic leader Sigmar Gabriel has expressed doubts about Germany's capacity to absorb the numbers that are expected. Chancellor Merkel insists, however, quote, that if Europe fails on the question of refugees, its close connection with universal civil rights will be destroyed. This is an existential challenge for the EU, whose internal legitimacy and foreign policy stance is based on the universality of European values. Finally, and very briefly, I wouldn't claim to have a solution to this very serious problem that we all face, but I think any solution has to include at least three main areas, three main sets of issues. The first is tackling the root causes of emigration in the countries of origin. There, too, I would draw attention to three sets of factors. First and foremost, perhaps, political conflict, state failure, sectarianism, violence, and terrorism following the Arab uprisings and the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq. it's quite clear that the West, whether Europe or the United States, has played a role, for good or ill, in many of these situations. And while one understands the reluctance, both of the United States, the UK, and other European countries, to become involved directly militarily, I think one can say that the absence of an effective diplomatic strategy, particularly vis-à-vis Syria, has characterized both the United States and Europe of late. And it's late in the day, but I think there could still be a more proactive approach to conflict resolution in Syria. The EU has a particular responsibility in that over a decade, it developed a policy towards Syria and other countries in the Eastern Med that proved ineffective under the broad heading of the European Neighbourhood Policy, which is now being thoroughly reviewed. Still, when it comes to tackling root causes of emigration, the problems of poverty and political violence in sub-Saharan Africa and East Africa also need to claim more of our attention. There are those, too, who draw attention to climate change and issues in the context of the drought that has contributed to the push factors for migration in East Africa. So tackling the root causes has to be, I think, the first set of issues in any approach to tackling the refugee problem. Secondly, and let me mention this very briefly because Bob has dwelt on it, strengthening the EU system for handling migration and asylum issues. I won't go into these issues in any length now, but it's clear that existing arrangements under Frontex, for example, which is struggling to coordinate national efforts and has no really effective means of its own, need to be strengthened. A small achievement was the Sophia operation, named after a baby born on a rescue ship carrying refugees from Libya last August, which has brought in 6 naval vessels. But considering the number of vessels leaving Libya every day during the summer season, some 20 at least, and the fact that EU naval vessels cannot enter the 12-mile nautical zone of territorial sea around Libya, the effectiveness of this operation is likely to be rather limited. Bob referred to the so-called hotspots, which are perhaps going to help eventually handle asylum claims and speed up the returns of unsuccessful claimants, but we're still at the very beginning of that story. I've mentioned the need for an EU approach and not just a national approach to the question of safe countries, and the need for more financial support for Turkey, Lebanon, and Jordan, the frontline countries in this respect. So I think strengthening the EU system for handling migration and asylum has to be a very important part of our effort to solve the problem. But I would also say that I think a truly global resettlement effort is needed, as we saw to some degree in the case of the Vietnamese boat people in the 70s and 80s. Bob mentioned that there are some 4 million Syrians displaced outside the country, and a truly global resettlement effort would need to support a considerable proportion of these. The scale of the problem cannot be underestimated. Such an effort would need to involve the US, Canada, Australia, and of course the Gulf countries, who until now, although they have many migrant workers from these countries, have made no effort at all on the problems of refugees, and perhaps countries further afield in Asia and South America. For now, we know the US is considering an increase from 2,000 to 10,000 in the number of Syrian refugees it takes this year. This is important and worthwhile, but in itself controversial in an election year. It's perfectly clear that more needs to be done. Also, as part of a truly global effort, there needs to be an increase in funding for the different UN agencies that are involved, for NGOs that are involved, and other bodies that are active on the spot. A small glimmer of hope came from the annual meeting of the Bretton Woods institutions in Lima over the last 3 days, where plans were launched for a new UN and World Bank bond to be guaranteed by member states to pay some of the costs of resettlement. So I think these 3 elements need to be part of any attempt to tackle the problem. It may turn out that the 2015 refugee crisis is a turning point in the history of the EU, as fundamental as the reunification of Germany and the overthrow of communism. It remains to be seen whether the members of the EU have the political will and the courage to meet the challenge. Thank you.
First of all, I would like to start with good news to concern Dartmouth and refugees. Dartmouth College will be bringing here some refugee scholars. We don't know the number yet, but members of the faculty have pestered the administration long enough and hard enough that this is going to take place. Hopefully, we will have the first refugee scholars here starting in January, and we're working toward accepting refugee students who would like to complete their studies here at Dartmouth. So at least we have, you know, small good news, but at least a little bit that Dartmouth can do in this crisis. I want to apologize because some of my presentation will bring back numbers that the other speakers have already mentioned, but I think it's worth looking at them again very quickly, and I'll try to be as quickly as possible in my presentation in general. So here is the 2015,000 number of 15, the number of arrivals in Europe and the number of people who died in the Mediterranean. I think the issue within Europe as well has been throughout the years the normalization of people dying while crossing the Mediterranean. It was scandalous and absolutely unacceptable according to people, to European people a few years ago. Now we are getting used, unfortunately, to the fact that there are this large number of people that will not make the crossing, and I will expand on that a little bit. So 81% of the arrivals are from the countries that other people have mentioned. In particular for Europe, 54% for Syria and Afghanistan. And then we see a 7% from Eritrea. This is not a 7% that concern many European countries, but certainly concerns the situation in Italy. And then you see that Iraq, Nigeria, Pakistan are at 3%, and Somalia and Sudan a 2%. Let's have a look at Greece. It has this year 450,848 arrivals. 94% again come from those 10 countries in the world that are called refugee producing countries. And I'm using this language that I've taken from the UN site, it's the site for the Commission for Refugees. As a humanist, refugee producing countries sounds terrible, but I want to stress, not my language, it's quite problematic. So 70% of Syrians, 80% from Afghanistan, Iraq, Pakistan, and Somalia. But I want you to look at Greece and the percentage of people who reach there, because I want you to compare them to Italy. Italy had 138,000 people by sea, arrived by sea. And again, 47% arise from top refugee-producing countries. But here we go. The numbers are quite different. Nigeria, 40%. Somalia, I think it was 10%. Eritrea, 27%. And Sudan, 6%. So we're back to the issue of Eritrea that you saw constitute the 7% of refugees coming to Europe, but there are a very large number coming to Italy in particular. This is because of colonial ties between Eritrea and Italy, and also it's linked to the political condition now in Eritrea. Eritrea had a 20-year-long war with Ethiopia that ended at the beginning of the 1990s. And at the beginning, there was a dream for democracy. The president of the country at that time became one of the heroes of the war against Ethiopia, Ismail, whose last name I'm blanking out right now, but of course I know it, became the president of the country, and quickly it became a dictatorship, and therefore a large number of Eritreans are trying to leave the country and come to Europe, and the closest connections they have, culturally speaking, would be Italy, because Italy was the colonial motherland for Eritrea between 1889 and 1941. So I want to look also at data about the number of people that came to Europe across the last few years. And you'll see that the numbers change dramatically according to the conditions of the countries from which people come. There were 59,000 in 2008, and the numbers didn't increase at the same rate. In some years, they also decreased. If you look at 2009, the number decreased dramatically, even more in 2010, to move from 9,700 in 2010 to 2011, when 70,000 people came to Europe. 2012 went down again, the number went down again, and in 13, 60,000 to jump to 165,000 in 2014. So this is the image that you often see in many, or a similar image you see in publications, in journals, in magazines, and in newspapers within Europe, where many different rhetorics are being used to talk about the refugees and the migrants in general. And I'm saying refugees and migrants, not because I want to make a difference, but because in Europe the difference is being made. We are at the point in public discourse in which refugee is good, migrant is bad, which is a very problematic dichotomy. As people who migrate, it doesn't mean that they can go back to their own country and be safe there. Economic migrations are dictated by real, tangible problems that are really important for the survival of the people who migrate. So this idea of not accepting migrants, only accepting refugees, is extremely problematic. Therefore, the press in Europe is making a clear separation. I would just bring them close together as two terms that define people who really need to move somewhere else. So here is the image. And I said before, I can talk about Italy in particular, this image has been normalized. This is something that happens I wouldn't say every day, but almost certainly every week. If you think that 7,000 people a week have been reaching the coast of Greece in the past month. So public sensibilities have gotten used to this image, my students say I have to give trigger warnings. The next pictures are not exactly what you would like to see at a quarter to six today, but I will just go through them quickly. Some of these images have shocked shocked Europe, but I'm afraid that the number of children dying in the crossing of the Mediterranean is increasing, and I am afraid that our affective response to this happening will go the same way that our reaction to adults dying in the Mediterranean went just a couple of years ago, or maybe three, or maybe four. Of course, this is a drawing that talks about comments on what really is going on, what kind of reaction Europe and the world is having to this refugee crisis. Now, what has been proposed vis-a-vis Italy in particular is the creation of a humanitarian channel through the Mediterranean, so that the safety of the people trying to cross it would be, I wouldn't say guaranteed, but there will be a higher number of people who will make it to shore and not die in the water. This has never taken place. What has been created is something, is an operation that was called years ago Mare Nostrum, which is a terrible name because the sea doesn't belong to Italians, but anyway. And that allowed ships to go quite close to the shores of Libya and rescue people. That operation was replaced by Operation Triton because Operation Mare Nostrum was very expensive. And Triton only allowed ships to go offshore from Italy, but very far from the Libyan coast. So plenty of water in which people could drown and have other difficulties in reaching the Italian coast. Now, Triton has not been declared defunct by the states in Europe, but it is in practice defunct, and we are back to Mare Nostrum, as there is the intervention of many ships coming from Europe contributing to the rescue and going pretty close to the coast of Libya. Even Doctors Without Borders now has a ship that contributes to the rescue. And I would like you to look at a couple of vignettes that have been created in Europe that creates cultural comments. As I'm a humanist, I thought I would bring images and cultural comments to the situation. You see the Arab countries as lounging while in a kind of ridiculous way, Europe is trying to create a way to save the people. And here you see trying to swim to save the sinking ship that is Syria. Another one highlights the conflicts within Europe itself vis-a-vis the arrival of migrants, right? On the one hand, you're supposed to be safe in Europe, but there are a lot of tensions among people and a lot of anxieties about having refugees in Europe. If you think that Europe is a country of 740 million people and is debating where to accept 10,000 people in a country or 12,000 people in another country, you can see how problematic it all is, and I'm over-abusing the word problematic, but it definitely is. A country that is much smaller than Europe, that is Turkey, is having 2 million people there, and Europe is complaining about smaller numbers that are coming. And of course there are problems, but I do believe that there are problems that could be faced, and thank you for the previous thank you to the previous speaker. We have some solution being proposed. Here we have examples that recall that image of the dead child that you saw at the very beginning of this sand clock through which one person at a time could be accepted in Europe itself. And here is, of course, the image of the Pope. And the Pope came late into the discourse of refugees to Europe because, of course, there is the opposition, Muslim refugees and the Catholic Church. A couple of months ago, he decided that the Vatican would host two refugee families, sorry if I smile, and then each parish in Italy would have to accept one refugee family. Of course, we have had some harsh reactions on the part of local priests who said they would rather burn down their parish than accept Muslim refugees. Of course, there are Christian Syrians, but anyway, so you see how within Europe itself, even under the direction of the Pope, there is a lot of conflict that this crisis has brought, made evident. Here is a group of new Italians and older Italians with sangue nostrums that actually mocks the Mare Nostrum operation that was not completely successful in rescuing refugees, but it also mocks the fact that these refugees also migrate to countries that doesn't have a jus soli, they only have a jus sanguinis, which is a big problem. The law of the blood is typical of country from which a lot of people migrated, like Italy or Greece. So if people are born from Italian parents with Italian citizenship, then they can transmit this Italian blood. And it's almost a biological discourse that comes from positivism, 19th century positivism, and therefore they are automatically Italian citizens. But people who come to Italy who have children, those children born on Italian soil will not be Italian citizens. Countries like Greece don't even have citizenship laws. So if you go to France, to Greece, you will never become a Greek citizen, although Greek Albanians played a big role in the liberation of Greece from the Turkish domination at the beginning of the 19th century. Here there is another vignette, and actually refers to this fact that Greece very much wants to focus on Greek blood, and it mocks this idea that only Greek people should go to Greece. Here is the front page of an Italian newspaper, Il Manifesto, who borrows some language from American politics and talks about pro-life, but the signs say, stop the slaughter and protect people, not borders. So I would like to stop here, and there's a lot of information that could be given, but I think it's important for you to ask the questions that you want to ask to any of us.
Yes, we are short on time. We may run a little over if there are an abundance of questions, but why don't, I'll take the prerogative of the chair and not ask the first question. So, up there in the back. Can you just wait for the mic?
Oh, thanks. Just going back to what you had said to Congress last week about our allies in the region and how they've been silent for the most part. And going back to your cartoon where there was Qatar and the UAE, I think, on the two floats, where's Netanyahu been on helping us with the Syrian refugee crisis and maybe taking some refugees, considering they are one of our allies and essentially should be as much of an ally to the European Union as we are? Why aren't they doing more to help?
Well, just very briefly, so there was a discussion in Israel about accepting Syrian refugees. The Labor Party proposed it. The government, Prime Minister Netanyahu, said that they would not do that. It's a very complicated issue. I would recognize the fact that Israel and Syria still have a state of war. So, you know, there are a lot of problems out there. I don't think that that is the foremost one in dealing with the refugee crisis at the moment.
Hi. Thank you for providing this forum here. I have not heard of anything going on in the Upper Valley, other than what this lady said about Dartmouth, which was wonderful that Dartmouth is going to be bringing some people here. I'd like to, at this place, find out what is going on. I feel that with the different churches and synagogues and other religious groups, town groups, lake associations, I think that there's a lot of very kind people in the Upper Valley, and I'd like to propose that as some organization, maybe the Interfaith Alliance or someone like that, could get some system set up. I think that there'd be different people who could each, different families who could perhaps offer to host one or two or three people for a month at a time, where there could be, say, a particular organization that would say, within our community, we could maybe host a total of 10 people by getting different members of the community to volunteer for a month at a time. So it's just an idea I wanted to bring up, and I haven't heard anything yet about how people in the Upper Valley can actually somehow help host people, and maybe more than a month at a time, depending what someone felt they could do.
I suggest that you contact the Lutheran Church here on campus. They are mobilizing in that regard, and there is going to be another church in Lebanon that will be working toward receiving refugees.
My name is Kathleen Agan. I worked for several UN agencies. I have my own international nonprofit. And Daniel, I sent you an email recently with an editorial I'd written for the Hearst Newspaper Network on the refugee crisis, and a letter I just sent to the New York Times on refugees are not migrants. And let's define the terms properly. Refugees, asylum seekers, migrants, and immigrants all have a distinct political, legal, and cultural meaning. When we jumble the terms together, it adds to the confusion of the way the refugees are being treated so inhumanely. Refugees, as I'm sure Daniel knows and Bob knows, are protected under the 1951 Convention on Refugees at the UN. They can't be turned back to their country of origin if their country of origin is in total chaos. Right? Right?
Yes.
Right.
I was not questioning that there are different definitions that mean different things. I was finding, again, problematic the ways that the terms are used now in Europe in political discourse as two things completely separate, and one is positive and one is negative.
I know, yeah. But major media like the BBC, the New York Times, Washington Post, I just picked up a paper the other day, first paragraph, they refer to them as if these are synonyms, and they aren't. Migrants aren't protected by any international treaty or laws. And I think it just adds to the confusion if we made it clear you can't do this to refugees. They couldn't be treated the way they're being treated in Hungary, for example. Daniel, do you agree with me?
So, obviously these are different categories, but I do have a lot of sympathy with the point Graziella made, which is that many of the people who are categorized as migrants who leave homes that they would otherwise prefer to stay in because of extreme want, the moral difference between that and the other reasons that people leave, it's getting harder and harder to understand those distinctions. So yes, we do have categorizations, we do have the 1951 convention, and we do need to hew to that to keep some order in the system, but it is a very tough thing to do, and it is very problematic when you have people fleeing countries in the numbers that we have because of abject poverty.
Yeah. Well, it isn't so much abject poverty, it's that the government and country are in absolute chaos and shambles, and it's a failed state. But I think the first thing in any discussion is define the terms properly. Also, I wanted to say, I wish we could talk about more that can be done. I don't know why the UN peacekeeping forces aren't doing more to try to protect the refugees. Bob, do you have a thought on that?
The short answer is no. I think it would be, I think there's international laws that would need to be navigated to welcome the UN peacekeepers into the countries. That they have to be invited by the sovereign state, and the countries affected have no interest in having the UN forces in there. I think there's a broader conversation here around how we protect civilians and the dynamics of different power and sovereignty that need to be discussed. But at this stage, I don't think there's much opening for UN peacekeepers.
No. Okay. One final question? Yes.
Hi, and thank you very much for this wonderful, wonderful information you have given us. My question has to do with the smugglers. Obviously, it's a horrendous thing. But if they weren't there, how else would people get along? What means of transportation are there that could be legally used today? Are the smugglers, in a way, serving the people to a certain extent with all the horror that entails?
I think one of the things that we as an aid group are advocating for, which kind of gets to your question, is that Europe needs to do a better job at providing safe passage and safe passage ways from war-affected countries and populations through to safety. I think Europe would push back and say that there's great amounts of safety within the hosting countries around Syria. And I think that at the core, we as a global community need to do better. My colleague spoke to treating the problem at source. I think we need to do a lot more to bring an end to the Syrian war and support the government in Afghanistan. It's like an onion. We then the next concentric circle out is that we need to make sure that there's robust enough funding to sustain humanitarian programs within the host countries around Turkey and Lebanon and Jordan. And then where that fails and people do continue to need, and need is an important clarifier to your point versus want to move from those refugee countries, then there should be safe routes that are managed so folks aren't exploited by smugglers. Because at the moment, yes, the smugglers they have a captive audience. There is no other way that refugees can move from Lebanon and Turkey into European states without visas. So I think Europe, the burden is on them to do a better job at protecting civilians as they are forced to flee.
Okay, with that, I think we'll come to a close. And I think it's been a terrific session. I particularly want to thank the panelists, and I hope that you'll join me in giving them a big hand. They came from far away, too.